Ow.
Jesus. Okay.
Do not have that upset. Oh.
It's a middle range. And look, I'm gonna speak directly to our audience right now. This episode will be entitled "My Friends Betray Me" about the format of my podcast.
Well, I don't think anyone really and truly, other than you, wants to listen.
And numerous other people.
To a scene by scene, second by second.
It's not second by second.
Replay of a movie that someone could just watch. They just want to hear about it, what we like.
Numerous people.
Welcome to the behind the scenes chat.
Numerous people like watching a movie than listening to.
Welcome to the Transmit Podcast.
Yeah, welcome to the Transmit Podcast. I'm your host,
Samantha.
Spike, the betrayed one. Okay, you know what? To be fair, and to indulge in the spirit of this new form of
I'm Victor.
You didn't say Victor, right? to keep in the spirit of this new form of reviewing, shorter, more distinct. That's fine.
Well, it's not necessarily shorter. It's just it's not going scene by scene because that's tedious.
You talk
about what the movie is about. You kind of give a brief-ish 3 to 5 minute synopsis, and then you start talking about the really interesting things that happen. You give people a real idea.
I'm willing to give this a shot. I just want to make it known that I'm deeply hurt on every level. So we're talking about.
It's just going to make me hate you less.
The movie Extraction. Listen, I'm used to women hating me. Okay, let's be honest here.
That's true.
Here's the trailer for Extraction. A little bit of it. He's jumping off a cliff, falls into water, and that kind of comes in
you're
later.
You're hoping if you spin the chamber enough times, you're gonna catch a bullet.
Okay, so
Sounds like an action movie. Sounds like an action movie.
You saw it. You said you finished it.
Well, I just watched the trailer, so I.
Oh, you only
I'm
saw.
I'm going to explain. Just want to say what the trailer sounded like to me.
Oh, wait! It did sound like an action trailer. You could tell because of the thumping.
Yeah.
Usually, if there's a lot of thumping, it's either a porno or an action movie. So, in the spirit of a shorter thing,
or it's coming from your room.
Or it's coming. Well, I know I've mentioned my masturbation is silent.
Oh yeah, that's true.
I've never been caught ever. Like a lot of teenage boys have that problem where someone walks in on them or like, what's that thumping? Nope, not me.
You ain't ever been caught. But your porn has been found though before.
Okay, you know, once. Jesus.
I wasn't going to go there.
Jesus.
My porn got found several times, actually.
Nice. Okay, so in the spirit
by
of...
By who? Other than me.
Oh, you found my porn before?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I've literally opened the laptop and I'm like, oh. He was watching porn earlier. Okay.
That's nice. Okay, well, in the spirit of a shorter, we'll summarize the plot.
Let's get into it.
Chris Hemsworth is a basically suicidal private contractor or mercenary who does all sorts of dangerous, dirty jobs, and he's trying to get himself killed. He gets shot. You think he's dead. Maybe not. Saves the kid. And that's the end of it. All right, so that being said...
so dumb.
I think this was a fun movie. Okay, no, not dumb, passive aggressive.
Yeah,
is the word you're looking for.
We should probably have some conversations about how to improve your communication style so that people loathe you less.
Listen, I don't need people to like me. I just need them to like
download
the podcast.
No, you need them to loathe you less.
No, I just need them to download the podcast. Okay, that's all I need.
Yeah, but don't you want people that you live with to not hate you?
I'm used to people. Not really.
So anyway,
okay.
Tyler Rake is the character that Thor plays, and he is definitely very troubled.
He's your basic 80s like action star who's like down, not down on his luck because he has like work and prospects, but he's living like this like slovenly lifestyle of depression and loneliness.
And like they do some really kind of interesting mirroring where... The very beginning of the movie, he's hanging out with his friends on a cliffside in Australia, and one of them is too chicken to just jump the cliff and, you know, whatever they call that, where you cliff diving? I don't know.
Yeah.
And he gets up and he's like, I'll fucking do it. And he just jumps in, and then he's sitting like at the bottom.
And this does come into a theme later where the kid says, like, you don't drown when you fall into the water. You drown because you stay in it.
Right. But he's just like sitting down there like meditating or thinking about life.
Yeah.
You know? And, but then he you know, he ends up back home and he gets
There's a really nice heli. He works for the company, so he's not, I don't know if he's contracted, but his company gets contracted, and I think he works for them. They're not too clear on that. He's basically their go-to guy. He's the best, even though he's like living in a cabin with chickens in the bathtub.
He's living a very sad life.
Oh yeah.
But they show that the somewhat rebellious son of a drug trafficker?
Yeah, a drug dealer, one of the big ones in India.
In India, gets kidnapped by
the
drug trafficker is in prison.
One of the bad drug dealers.
And someone else has his kid.
A worse drug dealer steals. Yeah. Well, and this is the weird thing, is he's not really like rebellious the way you'd normally think. He's still like a super nerdy dude who's nervous around kids, but he just sneaks out every now and then.
Because, you know, he lives a very sheltered life.
He does.
You know, so they send Thor, Tyler Rake, to go get the kid.
Yes.
And it turns into this brutal bloodbath for 90 minutes. It takes like, I don't know, 20 to 30 minutes for him to get to the point where things just start going haywire.
Yeah, I like the first bit where it's like kind of them hanging out, like figuring out where he is. And at first he's posing as like a negotiator to make sure that he can get he gets proof of life.
Yeah.
And then he beats the shit out of it, a room full of people.
Just destroys everybody.
And this is where you can really tell like the stunt team for the Avengers. This is the strength of the movie, is the stunt team for the Avengers worked on this movie. It's got the plot of like an 80s B movie and like the slick production values of John Wick.
Yeah.
And so that's what I really liked about it, because I really like good fight choreography. And that fight scene where he just beats up the people holding the kid is phenomenal and brutal.
I didn't see that scene. I missed that part.
It's the very beginning when everything just starts going to hell, because then they're trying to get the kid to the extraction point.
Yep.
But the kidnapping drug dealer finds out and he sends all of his people to shut everything down.
Oh yeah.
And
he's got the military in his pocket.
Kills Tyler Rake's whole entire team.
It wasn't him. It was the original drug dealer. They said like they froze all the original drug dealer's assets.
Yes.
So they gave him half the money, and then when they didn't pay up, he was like former Indian special forces. He killed their whole team. And that's when the other drug dealer's troops started showing up.
Oh no, okay. So it was wasn't that like his second in command?
Yeah.
Dude.
He's like fixer guy.
Yeah. But so like everything gets blown to hell and you just see this Tyler Rake's character, Thor's character, Tyler Rake, just getting progressively more injured.
Beat to shit. Over this scene that was, it's a faux one take. Mm-hmm. And you can kind of see some places where they cut.
Yeah.
And that's a really good like frenetic action scene where he's just making progress through the city.
Are you talking about that scene? Yeah.
Yeah.
I was trying to find all the cuts from that scene.
Oh,
they
yeah.
made it like one continuous cut.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty cool thing that like a lot of movies are doing now, where they like do CGI cuts.
Mm-hmm.
Where they go from one camera to the next and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty cool. So that was actually probably my favorite scene of the whole movie, actually.
That was a ton of fun. He does get the shit kicked out of him. It looks so tiring.
Like the camera goes from inside of a car seamlessly to outside of a car,
mm-hmm.
floats around like vehicles and stuff.
I'm going into survival mode.
It's like goes in the camera goes in all these different like
oh it does and
situations
like, it and follows stuff. It sometimes follows Chris Hemsworth, sometimes follows the kid, depending on you know where the action really needs to be.
Yeah,
that kid almost gets dragged off by like his tactical vest, which is great until he's like starts fighting back. It really looks desperate and fun, and
yeah.
Chris Hemsworth uses that like that karambit really well.
It's a karambit.
It's a knife that has a curve.
Oh yeah, in that fight scene.
Oh yeah, that last one where he gets into a knife fight after falling off a building.
Yeah, they seem to be really fine after a lot of these big They both get hit by a car.
That was ridiculous.
He gets hit by a car. Like Chris Hemsworth, he gets hit by a car a little less than Chris Hemsworth hits him with a car.
Like you just got hit by a freaking like a massive truck. He wins
the knife. Like yeah, it's funny where like Chris Hemsworth wins the knife fight and he's standing there and all of a sudden
car
comes out of nowhere. It's like oh he just died.
He's like oh he's dead. No oh no he's not. Well he's Thor. So this.
And then, you know, the other guy gets the kid and then like a bus hits him. And he doesn't fly up the side of it. He just gets launched by it.
Like a regular getting hit by a bus. But that's the thing. Special forces training. Listen, I've seen this and I've talked to several special forces people. They train you to get hit by a car and or a bus at 30 miles an hour.
Oh, okay.
That's week 4 in most special forces training.
Yeah.
Are you bullshitting or is this like
I'm bullshitting. Okay, bullshitting.
Do they work you up from 10 miles an hour?
Yeah, well, yeah. You obviously don't start at like 30. That's insane.
Right, yeah.
We're only human. Jesus.
No, but like they both literally your ribs should be
shattered. Just shreds.
I just want to know how this second in command guy, I forget what his character's name is
we'll call him Gary.
Still pursuing. Oh. Them.
Oh, that's an easy one. It's so the movie can happen.
Yes, but like in real life, that dude is crumpled on the ground.
Oh yeah,
bleeding internally.
In the real world,
like
his
hemorrhage.
His ribs have been shotgunned through his lungs.
Yeah.
So it. Yes. Oh yeah, that's the least believable part of the movie, honestly, because the like after that, they're all fucked up. Like once the adrenaline's down, they find a place to hunker down.
Yeah, like, I wonder if like you said it was like the Avengers
stunt team. Yeah,
I wonder if they're like used to everyone just being superpowered.
Oh yeah,
everyone's
like a
superhero. So they're like, oh, just everyone that's like a main character in
with
a movie
with endless cardio
from now on is just like is like Captain America basically. Everyone's got super soldier serum.
Oh yeah, like let me assure you, like I do sparring and like if somebody decides I'm gonna go to clinch and both of our bodies are gonna have to push against each other and fight. That in and of itself is draining. And Chris Hemsworth, like, against three dudes is, like, just pushing, like, three guys.
I know.
Like, after the third guy, you're just like, okay. That's why we invented guns, because it takes the killing down from, like, your whole body to, like, just your finger.
Yeah.
So I was reading the cast list while we were watching it, and I was like, oh, David Harbour's in this. The fuck?
Oh, wait,
who the fuck does he play?
Well, he comes up next.
And then they show that he's he's like a former
contractor, yeah.
Contractor with Tyler Rake, and like they don't like, no, we shouldn't call this guy, and like, no, call them. We're literally trapped in a sewer and there's rats and everything smells like shit.
Oh yeah.
That looks and awful. And it's the dude, and you're like, oh shit, it's David Harbour, and you think, okay, this is gonna be great. He's going to be awesome. Tyler Rake bonds with the kid.
He's so charming and friendly.
Like just like the nicest kid. Because, you know, it's at that point where the company's like, dude, just ditch this fucking kid. This is not worth it.
And this
he's
is where
like, no, I have to keep protecting this child.
And blah, this is about blah, the blah. Time you start learning about why he's so depressed and why he's not going to do it.
Yeah. He's like, oh, are you married? And he's like, yeah, I was, but I haven't seen her in a long time. And he's like, oh, did you have any kids? And he said, yeah, I had a son. They're like, well, what happened? How old was he? He was 6. And he died. I didn't understand. Like, what did he say happened? Because he
died of leukemia.
Leukemia. Okay. While the dude was in, like, I don't know, he said Bahrain or something.
Yeah.
So
he avoided it. It was like that movie with Liam Neeson where he's like, he was a cop who, like, worked instead of watching his kid die. He has that same problem where he buried himself in work. And he regrets not being there at the end.
Yeah, and then we find out that we're not really going. We're kind of going scene by scene a little bit. I guess
this is an important character developing portion.
We're still going over, you know, a little bit.
This is important character. This is the stuff you're really talking about. You don't need to go scene by scene with the action. That's why I was going to talk about this one, because you just say that whole scene really well done.
But David Harbour turns out to betray, and he's like, "No, we're going to get $10 million, and we'll split it." And you think that this is going to be like, you know, it's just going to be terrible. And David Harbour's character, Gaspar, and Tyler Rake are just going to kill each other. And then the fucking kid comes in and he shoots him.
Just double tap.
I was like, yes! Because I kind of predicted it. I was like, this isn't going to end well. The kid's going to have to come in and save the day. And he did.
This has a real Last of Us vibe in that way.
It's, I have never seen Last of Us.
It's a good game. You should play that game. That video game.
It was just a really nice development for this kid to, you know, kind of be this...
Kill someone in cold blood.
Sheltered kid who's being dragged through the forest, then dragged through a city and a sewer, and, you know, just at everyone's mercy. And then the person who has been protecting him is in trouble, and he's like, I got to step up. You know, because he's surrounded by, you know, terrible people because his father's a drug trafficker. But,
yeah, they didn't, you know. They wanted to give some of the body count to the kid, you know.
Well, yeah, everyone needs this is, a,
this
at least one
there's
kill.
So much murder in this movie that even the kids murder people.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, because that was one of the things. When you meet the worst drug dealer, he's like throwing kids off a roof.
Oh, God.
I know. That's
that, was his, that was terrible. Like,
that was also in the movie Boggy. Is there something about Indian films and throwing kids off of roofs?
Listen,
is that like a trope?
In the Asian continent, that area, like throwing people off roofs seems to be like modus operandi.
Kids specifically.
And, well, kids specifically, listen, gravity does a lot of work for you in that case.
And then there's the whole thing with the fingers.
Oh, yeah. He goes Japanese with that. Like he learned a lot from the Yakuza.
Yeah. He's like, I guess drug dealers, for some reason, they want to... they want your fingers for some reason.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and they also use kids because kids are cheap and very expendable because you're not really training them. And then there's always more.
And they don't know any better.
Yeah. And I'm not sure how good the that one kid who's like the smart one. Yeah. He's like, oh, you threw the kid who stole from you off the roof. And
he's like, oh, well, then I guess you'll have to pay for it.
But he's like, oh, smart and lucky, because that's when he finds out like the kid got stolen.
Yeah.
And it was kind of weird how that whole thing turns out. I think that conclusion wasn't all that great because before they hunker down for the night, Liam Neeson could do this too. Let's be honest. Chris Hemsworth, he humiliates that kid.
Like, okay, that was actually like a really fantastic scene. I thought
I liked it
because here's these children with guns and fucking hatchets and shit coming at him. And he is doing his damnedest not to kill any child. He beats the shit out of him. He smacks someone's face through glass and just like stomps the dog shit out of them.
Throws a kid against a van or something
but
like that.
But he doesn't
against the dumpster
kill them. And he's just like, man, these fucking kids. And it was actually like a really, I thought that was an interesting part of his character development that, you know, he's this pretty much brutal, cold-blooded mercenary.
But he's not going to kill a kid.
But he's not going to kill kids, no matter how aggressively they're trying to kill him.
It feels like they sold it a little too much, like the disdain he had. Like, but that's why, to communicate, like, he's humiliating this kid.
True.
And that's why he's like, that's why the kid's later, he's like, I need to pull the trigger on this motherfucker.
He cuts off his own finger.
Yeah, because he felt
shame, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Then he gives it to him at dinner, and he's like, I'm eating.
Well, the next scene that follows is pretty good, because they kind of do this thing at the beginning of the movie. They show Chris getting shot, and then they skip back to like the beginning of the movie. It's like one of those, like, here's a snippet from the end of the movie. Now let's go to the beginning.
Yeah, that was actually kind of...
I didn't like that part as much. I don't think that was necessary.
No. But you're like, well, God, at what point during the movie am I going to get to this part?
Yeah, so, and once you get to the bridge, you're like, oh, here it comes, and now it's like you're popped from the movie because you're thinking... Where is it happening? Oh. When's it happening?
I did not see that part.
Okay,
it was literally the opening. Well, that's because it took us like 3 days to watch this because things kept happening. We kept getting interrupted. We were like 5 minutes in, and then we were like 20 minutes in. And then he was like, how fucking long is this movie? How long have we been watching? And I'm like, we're only 30 minutes in. He's like, what the fuck?
Well, I'm glad I didn't see that part because I wasn't like waiting for that part to happen.
Yeah.
Like, that was a surprise to me at the end.
Yeah, they could have, that wasn't super, I mean, I guess part of why it was necessary is because they're always showing you he's remembering, you know, this sort of blurred out beach, you know, holding his wife's hand and then,
his,
you know,
kid's
there's like
there,
a kid.
Yeah.
And then they showed that in the very beginning where he's like dying a little bit and it's still blurry, but then they actually get you to that scene, that snippet again, like in the actual scene on the bridge. And then, you know, he's actually seeing it clearly. Then you actually get to see his kid's face because it kind of built that up when
they did. Yeah,
he was having his, you know, bedtime storytelling.
That's true. So after they bunker down for the night, he teams up with the Special Forces original drug dealer guy.
Yeah. So he ends up calling the other dude, and he's like, "We got to work together."
It's like, I have
to save this kid. I have to save this kid. So we can get the fuck out.
Gives him
of
a
India.
Gives him a bag full of guns and says, "Go with God." And that's really a true friend. Huh. Like, listen, if you give a man a bag full of guns and say, "Go," like you are a true friend.
So you know that this guy is this.
He's a killer.
The secondary, second in command dude.
Randeep.
Randeep, is that what
was his name? Randeep Hooba or something.
That's the actor's name. Yeah. So Randeep's character, they showed, was he was threatened by Ovi's dad that, you know, if you don't get my kid back,
I'm gonna kill your family.
Your child is not going to make his next birthday.
Yeah.
And so, like, there's a little bit of humanization there, but you know that, like,
he's
just brutal.
He's been working for a drug cartel in India for his entire... It's not like he's, like, they got him from, like, the Peace Corps. He's been changing his ways and giving God to the poor masses. He's been the enforcer for a drug dealer.
Yeah. So like he's helping them try to get across this bridge because they've completely shut down.
Oh yeah,
the entire city, like all of the bridges, all of the airports, everywhere is completely shut down.
Can you imagine just being like a regular person living in that city and being like, well, why is everything getting shut down? Like, I'm just trying to, you know,
I just want to buy my groceries.
And then there's like a bunch of guards saying, no, you can't leave. And
it's like, there's a lot of gunfire today. And there's like one white dude running around shooting a lot of our police officers. Because that's a pretty good fight scene. Like when they start up again, like he's like causing a distraction. And he like uses the old thump gun. Like it was like a Vietnam era style thing. I forget what they call that.
Yeah.
M203, I think.
Is this when he gets to the bridge or is this like...
This is before, like when they're first starting to make their way to the bridge.
Yeah. Is he like in the apartment buildings or something?
He's like in some sort of like, I don't know what it is. It's not an apartment, but it's like, it's got a big area for him to shoot from at the police.
Oh.
So he starts launching grenades and he's doing some really good work with that AR variant with a suppressor.
Yeah. It's crazy how much this guy kills more people than John Wick in this movie.
Oh, he does. And I think that, yeah, this is like grittier, like not grittier as in like storytelling wise, but grittier as in like just dirtier John Wick. Like everyone is just filthy and sweaty.
Yeah.
It's like in John Wick, everyone is like even when they get bloodied, their suit looks good.
Yeah. Everyone put some cologne on first before they left the house.
Little aftershave, they make sure that their undershirts never like wet with sweat, but then even though they're like fighting the shit out of each other.
Yeah. Yeah. But in this movie, everyone's like, you know, not shaven. Probably haven't bathed
in a week.
Sweat
stains everywhere.
Yeah.
And he does, he's like double tapping people. Yeah, but Chris Hemsworth double tapping everybody.
Yeah.
What is double tapping?
Like you shoot twice at somebody. Pow, 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 pow.
Oh, just...
Yeah, or sometimes triple tapping. So, but he's like, pow, 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 pow. Like, it's really, he's got like this duffel bag that I never see him draw anything from, but he's just got it.
Well, it's like, he's empty, and then, you know, he turns around, and all of a sudden there's a new gun in his hand.
No, he has the same gun for most of it. He has, like, two guns.
There's a new clip in his hand.
There's a new mag, yeah. So he's got, like, the vest, with the tactical vest with the magazines in it. So he's got, like, the magazines inside, and then on top of those is the pistol mags.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is pretty tactical. So I guess he's getting some of those, because he has, like, two... he has some of those magazines are, like, attached to each other, like jungle magging it, or jungle clipping it. So I guess that's where he's getting some of them.
I like how whenever he gets a new weapon, it like pauses for a second, and then there's a menu.
Oh yeah,
of circling guns, and then he picks the gun.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it appears in his hand suddenly.
Oh yeah, it's really like it's really realistic in that way. Yeah. Super good.
When they're on the bridge though, they're like trying to cross it, and they've got the enforcer guy, and you know that he's like he's doing this because he really wants to get back to his family. Mm-hmm. But then they have that...
The general guy says, give me my rifle.
Who's up in like this...
He's in another
apartment or building. Office building.
With like a G36 they use as a sniper rifle? Come on, guys.
Is that not a sniper rifle?
Like, if you modify the shit out of it, you can. But it's like usually chambered in 5.56. That's not really a good sniper round. You want like a Dragunov and something chambered in a 308. I think it's just a very distinctive looking gun.
So they're trying to get across the bridge, and like this guy is like he's protecting the kid,
yeah,
And then he's like, what is staying next to like a school bus or something? And then all of a sudden, you just, you know, the dude in the office building or whatever, just like
right in the head,
right in the head. And I was like,
oh,
fuck.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because he just completed a good
he took out like a SWAT team from a helicopter.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, and you're like, you saw like a positive turn for him, and then yeah. you're like remembering, oh God, he's got his kid, and he's like, I'll be home tomorrow, and you know, take care of your mom.
You're blah, the man blah, now. Blah. Yeah.
It looks like he's doing good. He's like killing a bunch of people.
And you're like, okay, he's really totally gonna make good. It, and yeah. then fuck,
sniped,
he's dead, and you're just like. Shit, now we've got Chris Hemsworth, who is literally bleeding from 30 different holes.
Oh yeah, he's been shot multiple times.
He has been?
Yeah, he's like, he's been sliced and diced and shot and broken.
The tactical vest probably took a few of those shots, but he's still like, he's bleeding.
All of his extremities.
Oh yeah, like his arm was still hurt from yesterday.
Either he's really, really good or like the police in India are really, really bad.
Yeah, they're using cheap ammo. Like, it only goes like half speed.
But he's also, I mean, well, he's, you know, he's very specially trained, so, you know, he knows how to cover and make it so that only, like, shots are going to get to places where it's not necessarily life-threatening.
Oh, yeah, little known
unless,
fact.
Unless, you know.
Yeah, little known fact about special forces, they're the only ones they teach how to duck.
Oh.
So just, yeah.
Stupid.
They don't, yeah, even in the U.S. military, they just say, yeah, just stand up, bro. be a man.
Yeah, I was thinking about that, like. The amount of people that he took out, like the U.S. Army would only need 5 of those guys
seriously.
To go drop down in like Iraq or something like that.
Oh yeah, like
it's like yeah, we don't
Taliban
have to,
done.
We don't have to put 500 people. We just need to put 5 of our specially trained
Chris Hemsworths. And realistically, like you hear about like Navy, like they'll even admit like Navy SEALs, like Army Rangers, Delta Force, they're just dudes who are extra like have extra fortitude.
Yeah.
This is why they're developing those robots.
Yeah, this is why they're developing robots.
Like I was watching the whole time I was watching that movie from like the beginning from the first scene with that was in the city, you know, the first big action scene to like the last action scene. I was thinking like, does this actually ever happen? Like, has there ever been a point in human history where one guy has taken out like 100 dudes?
Yes.
Maybe not 100 dudes like that, but like there are there are tales of special forces dudes, like just one SAS dude kicking in a door in Afghanistan and clearing out a building. Like, but you have to be high level and they have to be kind of suck.
Or you're in a guarded position. You
that
can
too.
Pick them off.
Yeah, guarded position, like a belt fed, like the machine gunners at Normandy, like the Nazis. They kill a lot of people.
Well, yeah, I'm just talking about the way that they do, like John Wick.
In this one,
No.
Because that was a martial arts movie with guns. Like, no one's going to come at John Wick one at a time from different angles, and he's going to be able to, like, look at it. But it looks phenomenal. So, this is about the time. After, like, Chris Hemsworth gets to the bridge, and he gets shot once. Like, he's, like, still taking out people. And Chris Hemsworth's company shows up in force, and they got a helicopter. And the helicopter probably gets sniped, and, like, one of the underlings takes up control. And that was kind of scary. I actually like that bit. And so
they land it, and the Nico chick is there, and she's, you know, she's coming from the other direction.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the enforcer dude is dead.
General dude's sniping.
Chris Hemsworth's character is fucked the fuck up.
Yep.
And he tells the kid,
right,
fucking run.
Go,
just
mate.
Run. The kid's like, I can't. I don't want to. And he's like, just run. And meanwhile, the Nico is like seeing that all of this sniping has been happening. And so she's like.
Oh, before that, she does a badass move where she's sitting there with like the RPG. She takes out the helicopter.
Yeah.
Badass.
She's a pretty good character.
Yeah, she has, but she has a scar, which is with a pretty long barrel, actually. So it's probably chambered in .308 or .762, which is a pretty good sniper round. So she has a better sniper weapon than that guy in his G-36 or G-30-something.
And she's just watching, because like you think that Chris Hemsworth is going to get shot by this dude from the office building.
He does get shot once by it.
But you think that he's going to get
the
headshot.
Yeah.
You think he's going to get the headshot. And so she's like scanning everywhere, and then all of a sudden she's like, he shoots another shot, and she's like, oh, where'd that come from? And she gets, and I'm like, oh, she's gonna get him right between the eyes, but she gets him in the forehead. I was like,
that's pretty
good.
I
was hoping it was gonna be like a really, you know, cinematic, like right between the eyes sort of thing, but no.
He's not enough of a character, I think, to really warrant that, but he's still, he gets it pretty good, right in the head.
Yeah.
And so, like, Chris Hemsworth gets up and he starts fighting his way through. He's like, he gets down to his pistol.
He takes down, like, all of the last people, and he starts to turn to come. And here comes
that kid.
Shitty little fucking kid. Scarface, like, I want to be the one to take him out.
Shoots him in the throat with, like, an AK round, which is like a 7.62, but a shorter round than than a SCAR would be in.
Yeah, and then the kid gets shot at. Who shoots at the kid? Like, the woman?
The chick. And he just fucks off then.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was that kid's life was kind of unresolved. Not sure what.
Yeah,
the
that was one of the weaknesses of the movie. There was like, yeah, some of the plot threads are unresolved. The structure of the movie's a little weak.
Yeah. But he's like shot in the throat, and he's put his hand to it, and he's turning and looking. And the kid's like already like,
oh, they drag
what
him
like
away.
50 yards away. Oh, yeah. Or something, and like they make the eye contact, and the kid's like, no, and he like runs away from the dude that's like holding him, trying to take him to the helicopter. And then he's like running towards him, and then Nico comes out of nowhere and like body slams the kid away and drags him. And Chris Hemsworth is like, he's just make sure that the kid gets away.
Mm-hmm.
And then he lets himself fall over the bridge into the water. And
he falls in.
And you're like, yeah, he's dead.
Oh, he's so
because
dead.
There's so much blood pouring
shot, like,
from
in
his
the jugular
throat.
Vein.
Yeah.
It's just pouring out of his neck. And then he's in the water.
Hydrostatic shock alone would have like expanded that and fucked him up even worse.
Yeah. And so then, like, you know, the kids save whatever, you know, they get
he's
away.
Back
and
at school, like later on.
What do they say? Like 8 months or something?
Yeah.
6 months, 8 months.
Oh, and the drug dealer ends up getting assassinated.
He does?
In the urinal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, don't, dude, that's a spoiler in the review itself. What the? Hang on, bro.
Wait, this happens before he goes to school, right?
No,
it happens later.
Uh-uh. It's like midway.
It's somewhere in there. Look, let's take it one chunk at a time. Okay,
I guess that's a good place to
That's a good place to go, I guess.
To show, like,
since Vic fucked us.
He's in like this fancy restaurant.
Yep.
He goes to take a piss, and you don't have any inkling of what's going to happen except for the fact that he goes in there alone and he's standing like in a corner at the urinal, and you're like, "Oh."
Yeah, and hot
someone's going to fucking kill him.
Hot contractor chick shows up in a dress at the men's urinal.
She's dressed fucking
to the nines.
Incredibly. She's got she's just amazing, and then she like she walks up and he looks at her and he's like, oh, there's a girl here. And she's like,
suppressed
hi.
Pistol.
Pop. So, like, I was like, fuck yeah.
Right if now. I ever go to take a piss and there's like a really, really
you're
hot
just, you're
chick,
just gonna run.
Yeah. Next
like,
to me.
Fucking leave, man.
Then she puts like two more
just
rounds
fuck
into
fuck
him.
Fuck off after
and
there.
I like they show like the spent brass rolling around there, and it's like, listen, the things I would eat out of her ass, you have no idea after seeing her in that dress. Oh, dude.
Yeah.
I think you would have. I think you had that thought in your brain from the first scene that they
showed.
Oh,
no. See, before she was kind of frumpy with like, she was still like smartly dressed, and I would just like eat things off of her belly. But seeing her in that dress, no. Right out of her butt.
They show the kid, though. He's like at the pool, and you're like, oh, he's going to go from a big diving board or whatever.
Yep.
And he sinks to the bottom.
He does
a
the Chris Hemsworth thing.
Perfect mirror image of what Tyler Rake does in the beginning of the movie.
It rhymes, is what they like to say in
has symmetry.
It's
literature. Symmetry?
It has symmetry, yes. Yeah.
Well, George Lucas says it's rhyming.
Okay, George Lucas made the prequels, okay?
Yeah, he said they rhymed with the original trilogy.
Yeah, that was wrong.
And he comes up finally for air.
And there's
and
someone
these,
who
there's
looks
like
all
a blurry. And I was pissed.
Blurry Chris Hemsworth. Well, see, they
because
both.
Like when he gets shot in the throat, I'm like, oh,
he's
yeah.
dead.
There, no one's gonna get him. She's like, no, we have to go. We have to leave. He's fucking dead. He is dead.
Okay, so here's the two interpretations. One, the optimist one, Chris Hemsworth survived, and that has symmetry with what they said is you don't drown because you fall in, you drown because you stay in. Two, there's just a pedophile there waiting to fuck a boy. So one
well,
of the two.
So what the writers said was
that's not the choice. These are the real. The
no. Those are your binary. That's your binary.
The writer said is, you know, maybe he did live, or maybe the kid is imagining seeing him, kind of in the way that you know he when Tyler Rake was you know near death and all of his experiences, he's remembering and imagining his ex-wife and his son.
Oh yeah.
And I guess that happened because when they first showed it to like test audiences, they were like, I really don't like the fact that he's dead because, you know, it's Chris Hemsworth, blah, 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 whatever. And it's like, well, just let him die. He wanted to die anyway.
Yeah.
You know, he died doing something for a kid that he actually grew to care about. You know, he was willing to sacrifice himself, not just because he wanted to die, because there was, you know, he bonded with this child. Let him have his fucking sacrifice. Yeah, like bullshit it with some wishy-washy, stupid-ass shit. Just let the movie stand on its laurels without making it seem like, oh, maybe he's still alive.
That's true. It's like a Man on Fire, Beauty and the Beast sort of thing. And
I don't need this to be a choose-your-own-adventure.
I was actually in the test group for that, and I was there, and I said, so is that a pedophile there waiting to fuck the boy? Because Chris Hemsworth is dead, right? He got shot in the throat. This is turning into an anime thing. Is that what I'm getting here? No. And they just came through like, no, God damn it, we have to change the movie. It was a very weird time. Like, I don't know why they picked me for that, but it was fun.
But I mean, I guess, you know, overall, it was a pretty enjoyable movie, even though it took us 3 days to watch it.
Took you the better part of a week.
To get around to it.
I mean, you asked us on like, I don't know.
Like Monday.
Sunday or Monday if we'd seen it. And Tuesday. We said no. We didn't say that we would watch it. And then finally, I guess on Tuesday, I was like, I mean, we could turn it on.
It's definitely not my genre.
No.
Well, you didn't like John Wick?
It's not the kind of genre of film. Nah, it was John Wick was a good movie, but it's still not my genre.
It's not your first chosen
film to watch.
Mm. You like super science-y space things.
Yeah, primarily. Like it was very gritty, realistic film.
So if Chris Hemsworth used a lazy zappy gun, you'd be like, this is the best!
Yeah, and if there was like space travel something. Like
if
that.
He had like a visor. Or if
it was about a video game that you liked.
Like, yeah, if he had like a visor that showed him like everyone's stats, you'd be like, well, this is just the best movie ever in the world.
What was that movie? Ready Player One? He liked Ready Player One.
That was all
right. Yeah, I like that movie. That's a good.
Did you like the book?
I did not read
the book.
That's probably for the best.
I read the book and I enjoyed the book. Hmm. The book was definitely better than the movie. But the movie had its merits.
But did the book have Halo Spartans? The answer is no.
Well, usually when I see these movies, though, they're not really done well. But this one had a really good action scene.
It has the John Wick thing where it's a very simple movie done very well.
Yeah.
It has the slick production values of your top-tier action movies with a no extra fat on the bone sort of like storyline.
So I don't get why he decided he wanted to sacrifice himself for this kid because his kid died.
It's him like making up for mistakes he's made in the past.
Kind of like a redemption.
Yeah. Yeah. If you played,
this is definitely a redemption.
If you played The Last of Us, you'd fucking know, dude.
No, no one's gonna play that game. No one's gonna play that game.
It's a great game. Lots of people have played that game. I want to replay that game.
Okay, and what is the console that it's on?
It's on PS. Well, the original version was on PS2. There's a PS4 version.
Yeah, so we'll never play that game.
Listen, you can borrow my PS4.
You loaned that to your sensei.
Well, I can get it back later.
He's lonely at home. He needs it. Okay, we don't need it.
It's not going to last the rest of our lives. It's in the future. This can happen.
No.
Tomorrow is coming, okay?
We're not going to play that.
Okay, plus, look.
I might play it.
Boom.
I really want to play that Rick and Morty game, though.
That sounds good, too. Have you heard about like there's some spoilers for the Last of Us 2, and it's looking like they fucked it up. You guys never play it. Never mind. Long story short, it sounds like they fucked up things pretty bad. Okay, look, I enjoyed this movie. Here we go. We're gonna do a thing. Here we go. So let's conclude this special movie edition, which I think is weaker, but we should do it like this every time.
It actually had more energy. I feel like
it took forever. And it was poorly done, and it was terrible, but we should do it like this more often.
I actually don't think it was actually very different from the way we've done it before.
It just felt fucking God, better. Victor. You know what? It didn't feel like we were going, okay, and then we did this, and then he did that. You know, it just felt a little bit more like an overview, but with, like, real good commentary.
Rather than
just a play-by-play.
I now agree with Vic. It was terrible. We should do it the old way every time now. I'm just going to, you know, this is my deeply held belief that I've never changed ever.
We can do a shorter synopsis. Maybe we'll watch something else. I mean, we have to do another blind taste test.
I think you and Spike secretly agree that this was a good podcast.
Yeah.
A feel it in your heart.
Thank you, sweet God.
I feel a little scarf.
Don't you throw me under the goddamn bus. Okay.
We'll talk about your scarf next podcast.
Okay, it's not a scarf. It's a shemagh. One, two.
The decimation of a shemagh.
The decimation. Desolation.
Okay, look. So, would you recommend it, Victor?
If you like action movies, if it's not your thing, if you don't like if you don't like first person shooter the movie, then don't watch it.
No, that would be Hardcore Henry. That's Did you like John Wick?
I like John Wick.
Then you'd probably like this one. You kind of liked it. You weren't like, oh, this was awful. Sam.
I mean, if you like Chris Hemsworth's body, and you also don't mind a lot of guns and
that's the best.
People getting run over by cars
twice,
and you know, the traumatization of children, then you'll enjoy this movie.
And I, as your host Spike, would say this is unequivocal. Yes, just watch it. Even if you don't like action movies, just watch it.
It's just a very Netflix movie.
It was a ton of fun. I enjoyed it. So that being said, I'm your host, Mike.
I'm Samantha.
I'm Victor.
Thanks for listening to the Transmit Podcast, Betrayal Edition. See you next time.